You are now listening to Extreme Cinema with Andrew Legank and David Lawler. If you like sex and violence, evil brunettes, and angelic blondes, then stick with us as we debate some of the best and worst of action and exploitation filmmaking.
And welcome to Extreme Cinema, action and exploitation movies with David Lawler, Andrew Legank, Andrew Legank, and David Lawler and Andrew Legank, and David Legank and Andrew Lawler. How you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
That's really good TV voice.
That sounds great, doesn't it?
You should totally do radio. Anyway.
I should, yeah. Maybe I'll do podcasts. That'll work.
You should totally do podcasts and sound like this. It's your wacky morning DJ.
Right. We're going to be on a podcast tonight.
Don't waste my motherfucking time.
All right, let's get into it. This is I was looking forward to this. Like, what did I say? I said, you know, okay, we'll watch Dead Heat and we'll watch The Punisher, two movies by Mark Goldblatt. And then we'll come back here in 2 weeks and talk about it. I already saw these movies. I watched them. Right mm-hmm. after I spoke to you. In the first right. 2 days, I watched The Punisher first, and then I watched Dead Heat. And I was already prepared, and I already started writing my notes. So I've been looking forward to this for 2 weeks.
What would you little maniacs like to do first?
So we have New World Pictures Presents, and both.
I love New World Pictures.
They did both of these, right?
They did.
Yeah.
They did. They were totally and in whole responsible for Mark Goldblatt's ill-fated directing career.
What do we got?
There's definitely something very weird going on here.
Detective Roger Mortis has a problem. He's dead. But Detective Bigelow is bringing him back alive.
That's okay. Don't get up. Told you not to get up.
Now, he's got 12 hours to solve the toughest murder case of his career. His own.
That's been from now on, I'm a vegetarian.
How do you fight this thing?
Maybe we could drown it in A1 sauce.
Treat Williams.
Sit down.
And Joe Piscopo are Dead Heat. You can't keep a good cop dead.
Unfortunately, it's ill-fated because, I mean...
We haven't seen him do any more directing lately.
Yeah, which is a shame because he was so... he did an episode of Eerie, Indiana in 1992.
Oh, God bless him. I'm glad
that
he got
must have been
him.
What finished him off right there.
Right, yeah. So we have Dead Heat from 1988, which is an extremely entertaining movie that pretty much got terrible reviews at the time across the board. Maybe critics thought it was tasteless or stupid, but I love this movie when I first saw it. Starring Treat Williams, Joe Piscopo, Darren McGavin, and Vincent frickin' Price.
Oh, God, yes. And Key Luke is in it.
Yeah. Always playing a bad, he's always like this ominous... evil Asian character. He was on
off of fortune cookies.
He was on an episode of Star Trek, the original series, a long time ago, but he played a good guy in that one.
He's awesome. The whole movie is great. This is like one of the best ways you could spend an evening watching Dead Heat. It is an awesome movie, really, for anyone, even if you don't like that kind of movie. It's just so unapologetically fun.
Right. I showed it to Bronwyn last weekend, I believe. Just for her to watch, because I thought it'd be really fun. Because I always quote the movie. I'm always quoting like lines from the movie, and she's always like, "What is this movie you keep quoting?" And I finally got it, and I showed it to her, and yeah, she seemed to enjoy it. She thought it was interesting. Now, the first time I ever saw this movie was actually on regular television, and I got to see the famous added scene, the deleted scene, because this is a short movie. It's about an hour and 23 minutes, so they had to add a scene to fill out the running time for regular broadcast.
Is that the Death Day Party?
The Death Day Party. We'll talk about that scene when we get to it.
Right.
Now, first up, when I ask you, when was the first time you saw the movie?
First time I saw the movie, I was, this was back in, you know, back when it first came out of the, I was psyched to see this movie when it came out in theaters, but I was a little young to go see it at the theater by myself. Like, I was going to R-rated movies about that time, but like I picked carefully when I did it, you know, and that one, it wasn't playing very long in the theaters at all. But
Yeah, I would say it's a hard R for violence, definitely.
So Dead Heat came out, and I was like on it when it came out. I went out and got it the first day, like that it was released on video. I went to Champagne Video on 76th Street and Broadway in Manhattan, walked on up there and got my copy of Dead Heat, and I brought it back home.
I remember Champagne Video. I remember. I think, yeah. I might have had a membership there.
Yeah, I had a membership on one on the east side and over. So I go home. And my father at the time was an agent for opera singers, and one of the singers was over there at the house. I don't know why. I'm coming in, and I'm like, he's sitting where the television is, and I'm like, dude, I'm putting this on. He's like, okay. So like, so I put this on. Like, I tell him what it is, and he's like, oh, okay. So I put it on, and we start watching it. And like, whatever my parents were doing, they come back in the room about 15, 20 minutes later, and we're both like, hey. He's like, hey, I didn't think this movie was going to be any good, but this is really good. I want to finish watching.
Just keep watching. Yeah.
Yeah. So we
did.
It's
never boring. This movie is never boring.
My parents came in and they missed like the first few minutes, but we all sat and watched Dead Heat together.
Yeah.
and it was awesome. It was great.
Oh man, that is good. Now I remember first hearing about the movie on Howard Stern's show on K-Rock back when he was on radio in 1988. He had a very funny interview with Joe Piscopo, and Piscopo was promoting the movie. So a year or two later, I watched the movie, and then we got a new cable hookup. I taped it as soon as it aired. I still have a VHS tape of it that I taped off a cable. And This was Mark Goldblatt's first of two movies as director. He had already established a distinguished career as a premier film editor with The Howling, Halloween 2, Wavelength, The Terminator, Rambo, Terminator 2, Last Boy Scout.
You had me at Terminator. You don't have to say anything more. You
received an Oscar
Terminator.
Nomination, I believe, for Terminator 2. Last Boy Scout, True Lies, and it just goes on. As a director, though, he has an excellent eye for shots, composition, action sequences. And I think
he was second unit director on RoboCop. I didn't know that. I just clicked it on. Yeah. No shit.
That's true. Yeah, that's where a lot of that experience comes in. And I have a feeling that he's one of these directors, when he was directing, that he was editing in his head while he was shooting.
Right, because, although I don't know what's going on in his head during The Punisher in that respect. Okay.
Some of the, because you know how an editor thinks. An editor thinks, I have a bunch of shots, I have to put them together, I have to tell a story, I have to form a narrative. And that's why Dead Heat, for me, is actually a very tight movie. And that's why
really
you can tell that story in an hour and 23 minutes.
I love that movie. I love everything about it. Like, there's nothing I would change. Except maybe treat Williams' hair.
You actually brought something up for me. There are a couple of, there's one thing I would change about the movie, but we'll get to that when we get to it. But a little bit of the backstory, I guess, is that this is a movie that was destroyed by critics when it was released. It's a movie I would recommend to people who almost invariably not understand what it was attempting to achieve. They would be like, is it a comedy? Is it a horror movie? And I was like,
yes.
You know,
the answer is yes to all.
Well, I would say basically my answer is, what was Ghostbusters? Ghostbusters was a horror comedy too.
We came, we saw, we kicked its ass.
But
I wouldn't call this horror, except for the some of the more disgusting zombie moments. But it's more of an action comedy, really. It's an action comedy with a little bit of horror in it, but it's not a scary movie by any means. It's not going to give anybody nightmares.
I didn't, you know, I put it on and I told Regan, I said, you know, this is kind of gory, you might not want to watch it. So she left the room immediately. It's not something for kids.
Yeah. It's definitely not.
Well, I would say when
Lindsay Frost melts, that's a pretty
the distinction between Ghostbusters and Dead Heat is that Ghostbusters is safe. It's very safe material. It's obviously meant to be goofy and not taken seriously. And this movie isn't really that safe because there's a lot of intense stuff going on. I remember when I was working at the video store. A girl comes up to the counter, asks me, what's the scariest movie you can recommend? And without hesitation, I said, Henry, Portrait of Serial Killer, because that movie really did freak me out. The girl asks about the movie, and then I realize that she's not going to get the movie. She's not going to understand it. She would give me strange looks for the rest of my life. Right. So I said, you're better off with Silence of the Lambs. And
It wasn't scary at all.
But, you know, the thing is, for the record, and I know, I don't know if I'm going to shock you or not, I didn't much care for Silence of the Lambs. I was impressed with it when I first saw it, but the movie doesn't age well. I thought it was
rather perfunctory, like, just filming of the book. It really didn't do a whole lot. And I was obsessed, as we've discussed before, with Manhunter.
Right, yeah.
Like, so I was kind of ticked off. Anything they would change from Manhunter pissed me off, like, because I loved Manhunter. And what I wanted to see was I wanted to see William Peterson again. Like,
right, yeah, that's the thing. Manhunter is a truly terrifying movie. Silence of the Lambs is not for me, because I feel like either Thomas Harris or Jonathan Demme, who's like an incredibly overrated director, understood. God, yeah. I don't think they got what psychopaths and serial killers are like. It's really silly to me, because look at how many Jamie Gumb jokes we do.
Was she a great big fat person?
It rubs the lotion on its skin, or else it gets the hose again.
You know?
Right.
I mean, it puts the lotion on its skin.
Yeah, everybody does that. Yeah, it's true.
It's way over the top. Jamie Gumb is just plain silly. He's not terrifying in the slightest.
Jonathan Demme suck. I mean, that fucking horrible, that Melanie Griffith movie that everybody says is so good. That,
yeah, Something Wild.
Something Wild. That movie is terrible.
Yeah, I know. I'm not a fan of it. And it's funny because
it was never good either. It's not like it's not like it didn't age well. It was shitty back in 1985, 87, whatever the fuck it was.
Okay, this is interesting to me, because Bronwyn studied film at she had a film studies class at Michigan State. Her teacher was Dr. Bill Vincent, who was actually in a couple of Sam Raimi movies. He usually plays a shemp, and he did a compare and contrast course where we compared the works of, I believe, Jonathan Demme and Alfred Hitchcock, and he compared Something Wild to Marnie or something like that, or The Birds. I'm not really sure. And the thing is, I don't think Demme knows horror. He cut Silence of the Lambs and also Something Wild. He doesn't really grasp the difference between comedy and horror, because for me, Ray Liotta
tone
and Something
problem.
Wild
always had tone problems.
Tone. Tone.
That's what I call it when a movie
steps
over the line. It's like where all of a sudden a movie, like, say, you ever see Downtown with Anthony Edwards?
Sounds familiar.
And
yeah,
Forrest
I believe
Whitaker.
I did.
Well, like here you're talking about a lighthearted action comedy, and then all of a sudden people's throats start getting slit
with
blood all over the place. And it's like, whoa, 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 whoa. like that's not the kind of movie this is. What are you guys doing? And that was really the problem. Jonathan Demme's movies have always been tone problems. Now, that was to a lesser extent in Silence of the Lambs, because it was, you know, he was really in the box that the book put him in.
Well, he was. But I felt like he was cutting it like a comedy, and it's not, it doesn't have, it's scenery chewing, I guess. Manhunter for me is terrifying, and the way it was shot, the style of it, you know, Michael Mann, always great composition, great music, great atmosphere. The first thing I notice is this great classic universal horror monster movie music. It's great. I love the music in this. It's fucking awesome.
Oh, yeah.
I'm starting to sound like you now. It's fucking awesome, man.
It's fucking awesome, man. You got to see it.
You got these thugs from a group known as Cash and Dash. They go into a jewelry store. They shoot up the place. They steal jewelry.
What are you doing?
Just looking. Shut your mouth and fill the bag.
Then we're introduced to Doug Bigelow and Roger Mortis, which is a cute name considering what happens to them. They're
Bigelow
cops.
Mortis. Yeah, Roger Mortis.
And Joe Piscopo. I mean, Joe Piscopo's listening to like this goofy obviously sound like music, and he's making goofy faces at Treat Williams. Treat Williams is obviously the serious cop, you know, and Piscopo is comic relief. They get a call from, they have a very cool car. He doesn't want to mess up, which is funny. They get a call from headquarters to break up the robbery. They get in with guns, and we see Robert Picardo, who is in a bunch of Joe Dante movies, usually, and including The Howling.
And then he's in Jack's Back, which is another very underrated movie.
Jack's Back is Rowdy Harrington, right?
Yes, it is. Now, there is a director we could do someday.
What happened to him, man?
I used to love Rowdy Harrington. He was awesome. Like, I always knew I would enjoy the movie.
Didn't he also do Gladiator with Cuba Gooding?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That was one of his best, actually. He did Striking Distance, which was not that great.
Striking Distance, I enjoyed. I actually liked that one.
Right, but it wasn't...
I did. I like it because I like the idea of a serial killer who plays a particular rock song or something.
it was okay, but like it kind of like my problem with it was that it started like it seemed like they were making the script up as they went along after a while.
Well, my only problem with the movie was Sarah Jessica Parker, who I can't stand. But anyway, so Joe Dante for some reason is thanked in the end credits, maybe for the use of his Robert Picardo. I guess he owns him or something.
Yeah.
So they shoot up these robbers, but they won't die. They keep like firing hot lead into them, and they're not just.
How cool was that scene when you first saw it?
I couldn't get over it. I was like, what are these people on fucking cocaine or something?
You're like, how is this happening? And I remember the trailer where it's like, you know, remember the good old days when guns killed people?
Yeah. Great line.
Yeah, you know, I was like, and man, what an opening for a movie. And what a concept. It's like, I'm surprised Larry Cohen didn't think of the concept of a man solving his own murder while he's dying.
That is fascinating, but doesn't it seem to you when you look at the shootout, the opening shootout, kind of a parody of action movies? Because you got all these cars, the protect and serve, black and white LA vehicles, right? They're all firing guns and all this, and the whole thing is kind of framed like an action movie, but it's a parody of it because these guys won't die.
Right.
He is like Dirty Harry. I guess Treat Williams is Rogers, kind of a Dirty Harry guy. He grabs Picardo's car because he doesn't want to mess up his car, which is very Dirty Harry. Smashes it into one guy while Piscopo blows up the other one with a grenade.
Yeah.
And then they get chewed out by the chief. I mean, it's got all of these beats
the black, bald chief yelling and screaming all the time, which was like a cliche of the era.
I want your badge and your piece on my desk.
Unauthorized use of a city vehicle. Reckless endangerment of property and lives. Use of a non-regulation firearm.
That was me, not Bigelow, sir.
Disrespectful conduct. Flippant and tasteless verbal remarks.
That was me.
And 18 parking tickets so far this month. Need I point out that you guys are already on probation twice? And that this morning's cowboy adventure puts both of you on the endangered species list? And that your badges go into the shitter if you screw up just one more time?
Captain, this man deserves a medal, and I think I deserve one for saving his life.
Look, I couldn't help noticing that in spite of Herzog's whining, you guys did the job he didn't. So, I'm prepared to cut you a little slack.
Thank you, sir.
But it would be nice if you could earn it by nailing the rest of these cash and dash fuckers to the wall with a 12-inch railroad spike.
Well, we're working on that, sir.
Work harder!
They, you know, I mean, like, for some reason, Piscopo spends a lot of time eating in this movie. He's always eating. He's eating a sandwich. He's eating leftover popcorn. He's talking about getting Chinese food later. So he kind of reminds me of Brad Pitt in Ocean's 11, where he's always eating.
Or Mel Gibson in Lethal Weapon, which was probably what
We get a cameo from Martha Quinn from MTV back in the old days of MTV. She plays a newscaster with really outrageous hair. Even my wife commented on it. She was like, look at that hair. So they go to the morgue where attendant Rebecca, whom I'm assuming is Treat Williams' ex-girlfriend, the way they bitch to each other. But
they bicker, don't they? Yeah.
She informs them that they're already dead. They've already been through autopsy. And then we're introduced to Darren McGavin, who is really great. He's wearing a seersucker suit that looks like it's right out of Kolchak, and I think that's probably a tribute.
So what's the story on these John Does? What's so unbelievable?
I'll show you.
Hey, nice shot, Roger. Thanks. Is there enough here to identify?
I wondered that myself. The teeth and fingerprints are practically worthless, but I noticed one thing.
What?
Stitches. You can see where the cut was made, traversing the sternum and incised with an electric saw.
They had surgery?
Nope. They had autopsies. They've been here before, fellas. I certified them myself. I even took pictures.
Well, we all make mistakes, Dr. Smithers.
Dr. McNabb, I am not in the habit of signing a death certificate for someone who just doesn't feel well.
Well, I would hope not. But the fact remains that either you screwed up or these two boys got up after you were done and strolled out of here.
I never forget a body, Doctor.
They probably gave him that because, you know, Kolchak the Night Stalker was a also, another...
I have to watch that. I have never seen it, and I
it's
hear
a great show.
It's
supposed
to be awesome, right?
He plays a journalist for a newswire service, I guess, like AP, and he's right. always investigating these weird murders and weird things that happen at Supernatural. It's uh-huh. it's extremely influential to shows like The X-Files and everything that came after. But it wasn't really? It wasn't that popular at the time, so it only ran for about a year, I think. But it's a great, great show. Great writing, great dialogue. Piscopo has a bit of dialogue about a death day, which is the opposite of a birthday, and it'll lead into yeah. the deleted scene we mentioned. He said, get all our friends
you're
together.
Past
get
weird, Bigelow. You're approaching degenerate.
Yes, yes. So do you get the feeling that Piscopo improvised most of his dialogue and his one-liners?
A good bit really, of it, yeah.
They flow very well, and they don't feel scripted.
So what? What if the show gets canceled and you guys never get to do movies or anything like that?
Say that. It's
good. I mean, you know, Charlie, you're very funny. I love those Rocket Reports.
You really mean that, Bill?
People are telling me you're imitating me, Charlie, though. I don't like to hear that. And watch your mouth. Clean it up. Who are you?
What's your... I'm Gilbert.
Gilbert? Gilbert, cheer up for me, will you, pal? Huh? Come on, you're a very lucky human being. You're very lucky, you know? Nobody walks up to you on the street and says, I hated 1941, did they? All right. And, you look very good when you comb your hair. It's nice. You know, it's when you do. You know.
Gilbert's supposed to be like this.
You know, Joe Piscopo, you're great. You know, the whole sports thing, the monosyllabic hollering and stuff.
Thank you.
It's inspired, you know, but are you going to definitely stick with Joe Piscopo as your name?
I was born with it, Bill. You know, it's my name.
Wow.
And the two of them obviously really like each other. Like Treat Williams is having a ball with him. Like they're having a good time while they're doing it.
You know, Treat gets some good lines, good funny lines too. But he's straight. He plays it straight. He does a great job in this. And you know, honestly, I can't figure any other two actors who would be good for these roles other than these guys. So we get back to Rebecca. She found trace amounts of an unusual drug in the bodies, which takes Doug and Roger to a pharmaceutical company, Dante Pharmaceuticals, enter the pretty
sulfathiazole.
Sulfathiazole, yes.
See, I have no notes on this. I'm doing this from memory because I've seen this movie so many fucking times.
Yes. So we meet the beautiful Lindsay Frost, public relations manager. This is a great actress. I don't understand.
Hot. She was only in like three movies.
I don't understand why she didn't become a big star. Remember we were talking about who would you see as B-level, C-level stars, and I was talking about how there were people who had so much promise but never went anywhere in their careers. And I was thinking
was one of them.
Lindsay Frost is one of them. She's beautiful. She projects intelligence, which I don't want to sound sexist, but as a filmmaker, it can be difficult for actresses because usually we're very fixated on how they look. We're not really fixated on whether
also,
or not
they're
smart.
They're not that fucking intelligent.
That's terrible.
I didn't say that. Who there said that?
You
Who
know, there
said,
are some.
Is Mason talking again?
Right. It's okay.
Sorry.
If he's got an opinion.
My cat likes to pipe in every once in a while.
You know what your cat said?
What did he say?
Jamie Lee Curtis. That is a rare actress who projects intelligence. And also, I want to think of Gillian Anderson, people like that. The beauty maybe doesn't get in the way of the intelligence, or the intelligence is enough that we think, hey, that's a smart person. But Lindsay, I guess it's her voice. Maybe it's the way she carries herself. She really does sound intelligent. She sounds like she knows what she's talking about.
And she holds her own with them on screen, like, you know, as a character and as an actress, she holds her own with them, which is hard because they have such a rapport. And right. But she's able to get in there and be a part of that, and it works.
Now, would you mind telling us what this is all about?
I told you. I'm their public relations person. At least I was until you two showed up.
How about if I work her over a bit?
Oh, I get it. You're the tough cop. And your partner here, he's the nice cop. Because he's not too scary with lipstick on.
Miss James, I got locked in that room where they killed the animals and some nutcase decompressed me, so I am not in a very good mood. Now, all I want is to find him.
Yeah, you know? I think, unfortunately, it's the difference between her and the actress who plays Rebecca. I don't really buy Rebecca, the actress who plays Rebecca.
Doesn't have the same quality, no.
I felt I bought those actors.
They could have. I mean, I bought her performance, but she definitely didn't have the same kind of rapport with them that Lizzie Frost had. No, not at all.
Okay, so Piscopo has all these great, like, Marx Brothers style one-liners, and he creates a diversion with one of my favorite lines that I'm always quoting to Bronwyn.
You know, Miss James, I gotta take a leak so bad my teeth are floating. Is there a little boys' room around here? I just got
down the hall.
Excuse me.
He gains admittance to the lab facility, which looks insane. It looks like something out of Star Trek. He gets attacked by this weird creature with fucking three eyes and two mouths and a big, enormous belly. It's like, it's weird.
How cool were the makeup effects in this?
Okay, yeah, that's a hallmark. You know, what I was reminded of is the reason they look as realistic as they do is because they probably did it the way John Carpenter did it. Remember The Thing, how those effects look so real because of the way they were photographed. Certain kinds of light, the way it shows on certain things, you know, if you shot that with bright lights and stuff, it would look fake, but it looks great here.
It does. It looks terrific. And it was a pretty harrowing scene. And then our hero, in trying to fight this creature,
right, he gets sucked into an air compression chamber.
Locked into a room where they kill dogs.
Yeah, I know. Did you notice? Okay, did you notice the? There's a shot of a dog in a cage that I guess is about to be air decompressed,
right.
And he's in there and he's dying. We cut to the dog and the dog kind of like crouches down and moans.
I didn't notice that.
It's interesting because that's going to be one of their she was explaining it. She says, unfortunately, when we test these animals, we have to kill them sometimes.
Right, right.
You know. And also, I wanted to bring up fish tanks. For some reason, we get fish tanks in most of these scenes. Like, Rebecca has a fake fish tank in her office. And then
the movie definitely has a fish fetish.
It's a fish fetish, yeah. And then we see later on in Lindsay Frost's house, she has fish, and she gets
Doug
pissed
gets
off because they
hung up in it, you know, like
and then Piscopo
he gets
is
drowned in it.
Yeah. So yeah. That's a weird kind of a visual cue going on with fish tanks. But so what happens? I mean, Treat gets sucked in there. He dies. Ooh.
Yeah.
And it's really
some evil person with black gloves on pushes the button that turns that on. And
the evil person with black, you know, the son of a bitch who killed him.
Son of a bitch, bastard.
There's so Rebecca shows up after
Treat Williams. What a terrible name for a child. Why would you do that?
Treat.
Treat.
I think it's great. It's distinctive. Treat. It's time for dinner. All right. Rebecca discovers that the drug is a preservative. They go into the lab, which turns out to be some kind of a reanimation chamber. And they put Roger's dead body on the platform and bring him back to life. And there's a great line here from Joe Piscopo that's very evocative of horror movies. He says,
"But the soul, Becky, what about the soul?"
"Looks like they may have found a way around that too, Doc."
"But the soul, Becky, what about the soul?"
"Dying." "Well, looks like they may have found a way around that too, Doug."
Which is kind of, it's kind of like a bullshit answer to give. I mean, I would want an explanation. Because that sounds like dialogue that the writer threw in there to kind of excuse it. It seems like a shortcut where the writer crosses his fingers and is like, "God, I hope they buy this." So they do this process, you know, and then Roger wakes up and says,
"Hi, guys.
You're alive."
"Of course I'm alive. must have taken a hell of a shot there.
Hey, Roger. Roger, how you feeling?
I feel... Hey, what is this place? What are you doing here, Rebecca?
Roger, we'll explain that to you later, but please just tell us how you feel.
Well, come to think of it, I feel terrific. I feel incredible. Ooh, it's great to be alive!
And he describes a very creepy near-death experience where he's headed toward a tunnel, and then they check him. He doesn't have a heartbeat. He's technically dead. Rebecca tells him that he has 12 hours before he decomposes, and she calls it an organic stew, which stew. Just sounds delicious.
A nice, greasy pork sandwich served in a dirty ashtray.
That's disgusting.
So he is technically dead. He decides to use the time to find out who killed him, and this is great. This is a great narrative setup. I love this idea.
Kind of like a DOA type setup, but cooler.
Which they reference. They reference DOA in the movie later. They go, and he notices his skin pallor is messed up. Oh, there's another funny line, another great Joe Piscopo line, where he says, Treat says, "I feel great. I feel like I could run the Boston Marathon." And he's just like
"No, you can't, Roger. It's not open to dead people."
Like, he's like, "Are you sure?"
Sure, is that a problem? Do you think they check?
And he's like, they're very strict now. So they go to the drugstore because he notices that his lips are all messed up. So he gets some lipstick, and what kind of lipstick does he get?
Mulberry wine. It brings out my eyes.
So what color did you get?
Mulberry wine.
It's a good choice. Brings out your eyes.
Go to hell.
Missed the spot.
Where?
Right there.
Don't touch it. I almost got it straight here.
I love it when you get angry.
How do women do this?
I don't know. Tribal memory, I guess.
So they shake down Lindsay Frost for information. They find a videotape of Vincent Price. And then there's another shootout with zombies.
Hell yeah. This is remember the good old days when guns killed people? Yeah. You're just jealous, that's all.
Great back and forth between those two. So Roger, also being a zombie, beats them at their own game. You know, he holds his breath for 5 minutes. Can you teach my girlfriend how to do that? You know?
I love this movie. I love this movie.
Lindsay lies. She tells them that Vincent Price is her father, but not really. She winds up, well, I'll mention that later. We'll get into that in a minute. So meanwhile, Roger has a mini poltergeist freak out. Where he's like in the medicine cabinet mirror, he shuts the door, and then it looks like he's a rotting skull. And it's a really nice moment. Right. Okay, but this is where I think stylistically you have a few issues, because it's like we're trying to be funny, we're trying to be a comedy, yeah, and we're trying to have these elements of horror movies and these elements of cop movies, but it never lets you forget. The story never lets you forget just how morbid the whole thing is.
Right.
Because he has a clock on his life. He's going to stop existing.
Right.
There are these constant visual cues that remind him that he's going to die. And this is our hero, for all intents and purposes. This is our guy. They go to a Chinese butcher, and okay, this is just one of the grossest scenes I've ever seen. Why don't you set that up for us?
Well, they go in there, and they're basically shaking down Key Luke because he's a provider. Sulfathiazole traces back to him. So they go in there.
Listen, Mongo, we're cops, and if Thule's not out here in 10 seconds, we're gonna kick some honorable ass.
Ah, Miss James, always a pleasure.
Mr. Thule, something terrible has happened.
Yes, I know. Are these your friends,
the police detectives? Got it right the first time, Pops.
We're looking for the man who takes deliveries from Dante Pharmaceuticals.
You have found him. How may I help you?
What did Dante send you?
Nothing of any importance.
Maybe more important than you think.
Your friend takes one more step, he'll find himself dead.
Life and death are both expressions of the same eternal spirit.
You ought to write fortune cookies, pal.
Let me illustrate.
so like apparently there's on the ceiling of this fucking shop of like it's like a one of those Chinese food shops with ducks hanging on the wall and shit. Yeah. And all this food that looks really good. Mm. And apparently there's a resurrection machine on the fucking ceiling in there. Now, why they have that there, I don't know. But, man, it makes for one cool scene when Key Luke just hits the button on that thing and it just turns on, resurrecting everything. And it resurrects everything in the room. And a side of beef that's not in the room.
Why is a liver's first instinct to attack somebody?
Because it's hilarious.
He's like, he spends a good 5 minutes being attacked by a liver trying to suck his face. And then you get like a couple of great lines where, you know, Piscopo says, suddenly I've lost really my appetite. Because
yeah.
He was talking about wanting to get some Chinese food earlier. Or
the
and...
duck head, like, this could replace the whoopee cushion.
And he's wrestled by a pig and he says, this little pig, he's going to market. And shoots it, and then a fucking bull.
And then this
or cow.
Giant fucking cow comes out, like, and it's like, well, how do we kill this thing? Like, well, maybe we can drown it in A1 sauce.
Yeah. it's hard to take all of this seriously, but it works, and there is a deeper meaning to all this, given what we eventually discover. Piscopo, okay, this is creepy. Had this occurred to you? It probably has. You've seen it so many times. But has it occurred to you that Piscopo is the only person in this trio that's technically living?
That's true. Actually, no, because you don't know about Lindsay Frost at that moment in time. It's true.
It's creepy if you think about it, because he's like surrounded by dead people until he eventually becomes one himself. He freaks out in the library when they're looking at obituaries, and you wonder what it feels like to be reanimated but not alive, and your body parts are withering and falling off. But you
can still think, and you can still think about what your obituary is going to be like. And like,
yeah.
But like, seriously, I mean, you could put yourself in that situation, as crazy as that situation is, and go, wow, what the hell would I think? You know, what would my obituary be?
This is weird. I mean, it's supposed to be a stupid action horror comedy, but it really does, it deals... This is so bizarre because it deals with death a lot better than most other movies that try to be more important about it.
Hey, Raj, what's up, man? You look all freaked out all of a sudden.
These obituaries. They're writing new ones all the time. They're writing mine.
Hey, now, take it easy.
Roger Mortis. Beloved husband of nobody, father of none. Who always thought he'd go out in a blaze of glory.
Roger.
I gotta get out of here.
Roger.
It's true, actually, it does. And like and Roger goes through these moments like this one, and then he's like, all right, I got to snap out of this. I got to fucking get back on finding, you know, the guy who killed me.
Yeah. And you know what? I just thought of this right now, because you mentioned stages, and I'm thinking he's kind of going through the stages of grief throughout this movie.
You know,
bargaining, denial, acceptance, you know, all that stuff. We kind of get this indication that something bad's going to happen to Joe Piscopo after he says goodbye to Roger. When they take off, they get into the car. Him and Lindsay Frost get in the car, and we have the shot of Joe Piscopo watching them go away, and you know that something's bad going to happen.
Right.
And this is unusual because it's unscripted. It's not in the movie. It's just 4 minutes later, he's found dead, submerged in a fish tank. And this completes the cycle of fish tanks in this movie. And I wonder what the fish tank thing is about, because I know there's some kind of a visual metaphor. I just can't really put my finger on it.
I'll have to ask Mark Goldblatt at some point.
Mr. Goldblatt.
Mr. Goldblatt, we'd like to ask you about fish tanks. What is the symbolic nature of the fish tanks?
After it's revealed that Joe Piscopo's dead, Lindsay reveals that she is, in fact, dead, too. And as she does, her body completely falls apart. And the movie, for me, it brings it to a dead stop because it gets really depressing. After that, I mean, like, it's like everybody's dying in this movie.
Roger.
Gets even worse.
Why did that depressing? Well, for a minute there, it is a little bit depressing and it's upsetting. And then when he finds Body Doc, then it gets back on track. So he writes a bunch of numbers that turn out to be a code that leads
numbers
him to Derek
to letters.
Gavin. Numbers to letters.
On his license plate.
Yes.
So for me, like the movie, now this is where the deleted scene is. It's right after Lindsay dies. What happens is Roger sort of passes out and he has a dream where, Joe Piscopo greets him in the afterlife. And he says, Roger, it's time for our death day party. And there's like this, all these dead people in this room. And
This was a cut scene,
but they restored it for television for the running time. Right. And it's about a 5-minute scene. And he's like meeting all these people that not only that he knew in life that died, but people that he killed when he was a cop. And they're all hanging out together. They're all, you know, getting ripped, like Doug said. And they're having a good time.
Really ripped.
But it was like it's a party. It's not like a wake. It's not like a funeral scene. It's like a party with dancing and music, and it's all these dead people. It's a very interesting scene. I believe
well,
you can
it's
find
sort
it
of,
on the Blu-ray.
It's sort of, huh? Sorry.
I believe you can find it on the Blu-ray.
I'll check it out. I think I saw it once a long time ago. Like, but this movie tries to have a lighthearted approach to death, and like it takes it seriously, but it also says, you know what, it's gonna happen, so you may as well fucking accept it and just and you know, party on while you still got the time. And
yeah,
like that's basically the attitude.
This is what I like, and I really like the idea of a death day party. I think it's great.
I think it's great if you could figure out what your death day was, man. Have a fucking death day party.
But the thing
have
is,
a death day party.
If I must get philosophical on your ass, lay some philosophy on you.
Uh-oh.
I think our struggle in life, the things, the pitfalls, the adventure, the journey.
Dust in the wind, dude.
All that we do, the reason life is a series of stress tests and a lot of horrible things is because we don't know the day that we're going to die. If we know the day that we're going to die, we would be very comfortable with that.
Check out the big brain on bread. You're a smart motherfucker. That's right.
Because it opens the door for opportunities. There's so many things you could be doing in life if you know when your number is up, you know?
Yeah, I could see how that could provide you with a number of opportunities. However, as that day gets closer, I mean, how much does it affect you? That would be an interesting thing to explore in a story.
It would. Absolutely. Yeah. Wow. Work on that. Give me a script.
Life finds a way.
You are now listening to Extreme Cinema with Andrew LeGank and David Lawler.
Let's all go to the lobby. Let's all go to the lobby. Let's all go to the lobby to get ourselves a treat.
Delicious things to eat.
The popcorn can't be beat.
The sparkling drinks are just dandy. The chocolate bars and the candy. So let's all go to the lobby to get ourselves a treat. Let's all go to the lobby to get ourselves a treat.
So this is, but unfortunately the death day party scene runs a little too long, so it brings it to a halt. So I can see why they cut it out. They just wanted to continue with the action.
Right, and they were lingering. They needed to get back, and like they really need the ambulance scene, which is like fucking awesome. And like
this is where we get to it. Darren McGavin is in the office. Roger confronts him. McGavin get his cronies grab Roger and they handcuff him to the inside of the ambulance, where it's revealed that they killed Rebecca also off screen. And again, we kind of have that depressing kind of a turn of events, because Rebecca's really just innocent, and
Roger just decides to fucking throw caution to the wind, and he doesn't
like,
give a
fuck
shit.
It, yeah,
what's gonna happen? He's just like, yeah, he's done with all this crap, and like he's gonna die, and he's gonna take as many of these fuckers with him as he can, and fuck all that shit. He's also gonna have some fun while he does it.
Yeah, what he does, he's handcuffed to the thing. He reaches out with his foot. He takes the car out of park.
You and I are going for a ride.
And then he smashes the ambulance into a bunch of other cars, and then there's a big explosion. The cops come, the ambulances come, they take him.
The coolest thing ever, the body bag scene, when they're loading him out. He's getting zipped up in the body bag, and, right. and he wakes up and scares the shit out of the cop.
Oh, like, he is a mess, too, but he looks really cool. He's messed up and cool.
Face.
And
yeah.
This is probably one of those things that's really difficult for people to take, because the makeup effects on Treat Williams are very realistic looking, and he reminds me a lot of, let's say, Griffin Dunne in American Werewolf in London, with all the skin hanging off of him and stuff, and it's just, it's really bad, gross kind of.
He looks so badass, though. He looks fucking awesome.
Like, I mean, he like shows the cop his badge. He's like, Detective Mortis. He says, like, you're a cop? And he takes the motorcycle.
Surprise.
Yeah. And then he goes down to Dante Pharmaceuticals and, you know, starts wreaking havoc and fight. Now, I wrote in here in my notes, this is a hard movie to watch when you're eating buffalo wings. Ugh. God, especially during that Chinese butcher scene. Jesus. So he reveals that he has reanimated Joe Piscopo, turns him into a zombie stooge, but he says his brain is far gone. He's just a mindless stooge now. He lets loose on the classic line.
I say. Kill that guy, would you?
Doug, you're alive.
He can't understand a word you said, Roger. He's been brain dead too long, which means that he's mindless and totally obedient.
Kill this guy, would you?
Kill this guy, would you?
Now, Doug, stop. Doug, it's me. It's me, Roger.
Kill this guy, would you?
Doug, don't.
Kill this guy.
Doug!
Would you?
Hey, Doug. Do you realize that we both have the same death day? Doug, you know what we could do? We could throw a death day party. We could invite all our friends. Get really ripped.
We'll do something.
Kill him, you brain dead son of a bitch.
Doug, remember the lipstick? Mulberry wine? Brings out my eyes?
Roger?
Roger!
Hi, Doug. Welcome to Zombieland.
Roger, he said I should hurt you.
but I'm gonna hurt him.
Kill that guy, would you?
Oh, no.
He's like, you know, and the thing is, I guess the joke here is that Doug isn't terribly bright anyway, so there wasn't much for him to lose when he died.
Yeah, so
Darren McGavin just assumed he was a mindless stooge.
Yeah.
Anyway, he's back to his old self, and he says, he should kill you,
but I'm going to hurt him.
And he goes, kill that guy, would you?
Yeah.
And then,
fucking awesome. Come on. Like it just pumps you up. Like
more shooting, awesome. more guns and stuff. And then they start going toward him and McGavin just decides, oh no, you fuckers aren't going to take me. And he just shoots himself. And he says,
cheated me.
He said, God damn you. You cheated me. So they bring him back to life and then they continue to bring him back to life until he fucking explodes all over the place. So yeah, everybody's dead
twice.
In this movie.
Like, you want to know what happens when you resurrect somebody twice? He's like, no, I don't think so.
So it's like all the lead characters die in this movie. It's like Hamlet. This, you know.
Then they walk off into like this.
Into the unknown, yeah.
Into the unknown together. And they're like, you know, Roger, I think this could be the end of a beautiful friendship.
great last line in a movie.
Leaves you happy. It leaves you happy with the whole thing.
It's sort of like, I don't know. It's like you feel bad that they're dead, but you feel kind of good that they're, I don't know, going someplace else. They're going, that there is something
They're hanging out together and they're happy. And like it never really bothered me at all that they died. It was like, I felt like they had tied up all the loose ends and, and that they were going off together and that whatever they did, you know, they were going to be friends. You know, I don't know.
I found an interesting factoid. Apparently, the movie was popular enough that they asked for a sequel. And the writer they hired said, all the characters are dead. How are we going to do a sequel? And the producer actually said, you have a resurrection machine. You figure it out. But they never actually were able to get... I guess this because this was around the time that New World started to kind of disintegrate.
I just love that movie. It's one of my favorite movies. I want to watch it again now because we've been talking about it. Like, I could watch it every day.
For some reason, it is immensely watchable. It's a movie that you can continue to watch over and over again.
I always want to watch it. It's always there. Like, I mean, like, I love it. You know, it's
there's something about the structure that it has a great setup. It's got kind of a high concept premise, but mm-hmm. the actors... treat the material with a certain amount of respect. They're not like, you know, I mean, it's like it feels real. It feels serious to them. It feels like we're totally in their world and we identify with them. Maybe that's what it is. Maybe this whole thing that I've been going on about death, it's because we really sympathize with Treat.
Yeah, I agree. Just definitely one of my favorite movies. Totally love it. And everybody should see it.
Everyone should see it, absolutely. We both agree, and this is where I'm going to throw in the Harvey Keitel clip.
Well, let's not start sucking each other's dicks quite yet.
All right, now let's move on.
What do we got?
To The Punisher, 1989. New World Pictures presents...
Yes, and we're talking the year of the fall of New World Pictures.
If society won't punish the guilty... He will.
You see this board here? Every time he kills somebody, I put a red pin in it. So far, the only thing that I've got to show for it is these little calling cards here and a whole bunch of these.
Now, let me tell you something about this Punisher. If he ever shows up within 1,000 yards of me, he'll find out what the word punished really means.
He defends the innocent. But if you're guilty, he gives no warning and shows no mercy.
What the hell is this?
Trouble.
Dolph Lundgren, Louis Gossett Jr.
Mr. P, happy hunting!
The Punisher. Justice with a vengeance.
Yes, the opening credits play like a variation on Tim Burton's Batman, also a little bit of Darkman. But then we go into a kind of Buck Rogers magic iris effect. With we have various shots of different things that we assume are going to be a part of the movie, and then we get Dolph showing up in a couple of shots firing an enormous gun, and I have to admit, he looks way cool. The music has this like 70s TV movie feel to it. It's unusual.
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
And so, okay, that this is interesting. The movie begins with the concept of the Punisher already out there. So
it's it's an odd idea to start like you're not really, and that's that. I think that was a mistake.
Really? Right, really? It's not an origin story. We only see flashbacks, a little bit of flashback of.
But when it comes to it's not an origin story, no. But
the Tom Jane version
movie,
is an origin story.
The first movie should be an origin story. And what's most interesting about the Punisher is his origin. So you're cutting out like some of the most interesting stuff about who Frank Castle is, how he becomes the Punisher, why he becomes the Punisher, and you're sort of glossing over that in favor of starting months into it.
Well, yeah, but that's doesn't it remind you a little bit
and
of
it
Batman?
Makes you gloss over his, but Batman had the origin. Stuff
well, no. Tim Burton's Batman opens with Batman already being out there, and then we get a little bit of a clip of what made him
flashback.
Batman. And then they kept doing it ad nauseum for every movie. They kept showing young Bruce Wayne watching his parents die, and that got boring for me.
Wing freak terrorizes. Wait till they get a load of me.
So it's like we slip into the story like we do with Batman. He already exists, and cops and bad guys are scratching their heads, wondering who the hell this guy is. They call him a vigilante. Now, from what I did a little research, Boaz Yakin or whatever, wrote the script.
Yeah, he worked canon a lot.
Right. And he would go on to write The Rookie, which was the Clint Eastwood movie with Charlie Sheen, which I enjoyed that one.
I did, too.
He wrote and directed Fresh. I believe I saw that, and I liked it. He did A Price Above Rubies with Renee Zellweger, I want to say.
Yeah, I thought that was like a Sidney Lumet did that. Or did he write that?
He wrote and directed it.
Really?
Huh. Yeah. And he executive produced the two Hostel movies for Eli Roth.
Oh, okay.
So I have to say, 5 minutes in, this guy is awesome. He stands in a doorway surrounded by fire after he's murdered all these mafioso guys.
Kill me.
So why? Yeah, and he says, "Why are the innocent dead and the guilty alive?" And it's great. Actually, Dolph is quite good when they give him just enough to say, just to show that he can speak. He's great.
Come on, God, answer me.
For years, I'm asking you why. Why are the innocent dead and the guilty alive? Where is justice? Where is punishment? Or have you already answered? Have you already said to the world, here is justice, here is punishment, here in me?
Yeah, he's never been the greatest actor, which is strange to me because he's such a smart guy. That you would think that he would be better at being an actor, but just not.
Yeah, there's a face. He has this kind of there's a great moment in Rocky IV where yes. I saw Rocky IV in the theater actually. In Philadelphia. Come on,
actually,
he's a hero.
Rocky
we have
was
to
my favorite Rocky movie.
One?
Rocky IV was my favorite up until some of the newer ones.
This great moment in Rocky IV. Now, we know the story. Basically, Rocky does it the old-fashioned way. He trains, he runs up mountains, he carries weights, he does all this stuff. But we see what Dolph does, what the Russians are doing with him, is giving him steroids. They're putting him through advanced electronic courses. And then when they get to the ring and they have to touch gloves, he looks at him. Now, Dolph Lundgren is a big guy. He's a huge guy. He looks, because Stallone is short. He's actually a very short guy.
He's really short.
Bastard.
Yeah. And he looks down at him and he says the most famous line in the movie, which is, I must break you.
I must break you.
But
yes.
He doesn't say it the way a lot of people think he says it. A lot of people think that he says it in this very stern Russian, I'm going to kill you way. He says the words, I must break you. And there's a kind of a look of sadness to his face. And I always thought it was really effective for Dolph's performance. Mm-hmm. And because he is under an enormous amount of pressure from the Soviet government to destroy this American.
Right.
These two are just pawns. And Stallone, a great actor in his own right, is looking at him with that kind of sympathy as well, which I always thought was really interesting. It's a moment that I don't think a lot of people pick up on.
Yeah.
So this is where, so we get to...
I enjoyed the movie. I liked it a lot when I first saw it.
I thought it was pretty good. I didn't think I sort
think it's
of
okay.
Had, I had
I
the
watched Dead Heat five times before I watched this one more time.
Well, it's interesting to me because again, we're kind of looking at a parody of an action movie because we get these Bruce Wayne style flashbacks of his family getting killed, right? And then we introduce Louis Gossett Jr., who was his partner when he was a cop. His name was Frank Castle. And Louis Gossett Jr. has been trying to find him for years because he's convinced he's the vigilante, and he's right. And he's got, he takes on a new partner, and he's getting too old for this shit, and he takes on this lady cop who was like doing all this research.
Bad casting, too. Bad casting.
Well, did you notice that the bad guy...
Nancy Everhard, right? And it's just bad casting.
I didn't get her name. All I knew is she had a bad haircut.
Great ass!
Yeah, terrible haircut. And, like, I didn't buy Lou Gossett in this role either.
Well, Lou Gossett isn't necessary. He's a great actor and an Academy Award winner, and here he is kind of, like, relegated to being, like...
He doesn't work in this role, though. He doesn't work... Like, this character should be much more intense and dark and focused on Frank Castle, and I don't see that from him. I see the Dean from Toy Soldiers. You know, like it's not like it didn't work for me.
There is a funny bit with Louis Gossett later in the movie where he's captured, he's tied up, and he keeps complaining that he's hungry. And then somebody shows up with pizza. He gets the drop on this guy, and then he grabs a slice of pizza and leaves, which
right.
I thought was kind of funny. But anyway, the bad guy. From The Fugitive is the bad guy in this movie, Yeroen Krab.
I don't care!
Yeah, and he's really good, actually.
Mr. Franco, how does it feel to be back home?
We're 30 minutes since I've landed, so far so good.
You come back to take over, sir.
Come on, fellas, it was a long flight, and then it's tied. Let's give him a break, huh?
Aren't you afraid of the Punisher?
The Punisher?
Yes.
You know what I think in Europe? You guys made it up to sell newspapers. There is no Punisher.
Then what's been killing your associates for the last 5 years?
Well, too much stress, I guess. Thanks for coming.
Come on, come on. Come on, vanish.
Just a sec. Can I help you, detective?
Well, you already have, Franco.
Really?
No. Kind of like a worm helps a fisherman. I'm glad you finally came home, Johnny. I was running out of bait. I'll see you around. Too much stress, huh?
That's funny.
I thought that they could have explored. I remembered more of... I remember the relationship between him and the Punisher being more interesting back when I first saw the movie than it plays out.
Yeah. I agree that it is. Yeah, that was much more interesting than any other relationship. For some reason, there is like this drunk guy who keeps giving him information. And yes. I was thinking that the drunk guy was going to turn on him and be a bad guy because it seems like he gets into bad situations when this guy talks to him. Or right. Something. I mean, I don't understand. It doesn't make any sense to me. His character, this yeah. person giving him information. How the hell would he have this information?
I don't know. But I think that's a character from the comic. So
maybe,
like it just sort of is that way. They probably just didn't explain it well.
Nice weather we're having for this time of year.
You were supposed to meet me here 4 hours ago.
I know all about it. I've been hearing it all my life. Checks, responsibility. Can't keep an appointment.
Where is the dope coming into?
The dope. The dope. Oh, that. Pier 30.
But I thought that the Jerwood Crab character, and it makes for a really interesting thing that the two of them are fighting together to save the his son, Jerwood Crab's son.
Yeah, who he has absolutely no reason to want to save. I don't know why he does that.
Who? The Punisher?
Yeah, he doesn't have any reason.
Well, that's what they need to establish. And I feel that they didn't really... I mean, look, he doesn't want their kids to die because his kids died.
Well, I can understand him saving the other kids like he did, but saving that guy killed his family.
Bastard.
Right.
You know,
but
I mean, why would you?
The kid didn't do anything to anybody. And that's what makes
the kid
interesting
is innocent.
Story.
Yeah.
It makes it an interesting story element is the two of them fighting together.
The conflict.
To save, yeah. While at the same time, Castle wants to kill him for killing his family. Now, it would have worked better if he wasn't the one who had killed his family. If he was just a you know, one of the guys that he's going
well,
after.
Yeah, it makes it really uncomfortable. It really does. I don't know, you or I, we wouldn't be doing that.
No, probably would just fucking kill the guy.
So there is this, they're getting drugs, but then they get in the middle of a drug burn. The Punisher witnesses all this. There's some nice editing in the scene, I want to say, actually. Good clean effects and good gory effects, too.
In the shootout at the pier?
Yeah.
Same weirdo editing that they're doing in the fight scenes. I don't know if I'm all with that. Whatever they're doing, it makes it look cheap.
There is a cheap problem with the movie. Like I said, the budget was $11 million. It was shot in Australia. You'd think they'd be able to stretch their dollars a little bit more, but it didn't look like they had that. It wasn't budgeted very well, I don't think.
I think they were trying to do too much on with what they had. I know they were trying to stretch.
Or maybe half of the movie, half of the movie's budget was Louis Gossett Jr.'s paycheck.
That's possible.
Like the biggest
well, if that was the case, they did. They totally decided wrong because I don't really think he worked that well.
So the bad guy is a bad girl, Dragon Lady, I call her, from the Yakuza, Lady Tanaka,
right.
Who meets with Yoroen, the mobster. Her guys were responsible for the drug burn. She threatens to cripple their operations, but instead she wants a partnership where she gets 75% for administrating, which is hilarious to me.
With all due respect, Mr. Tanaka, let's cut through the bullshit and get to the heart of the matter. What do you want?
A partnership.
Define the term.
You will continue to manage and oversee all your business on a day-to-day basis. We will assume the duties of executive administration, investments, and financial services.
Come on.
I'm not through. What do you propose as a split?
75% for us, 25% for you.
No fucking way am I going to be a salary boy to some bunch of nips, got that? I don't know about the rest of you guys, but the DeLeo family gives up shit. We don't work for nobody. Who the fuck do you think you are?
We are Yakuza. When your ancestors were still shepherds screwing sheep on the Mediterranean coast, as were the crime lords of Asia. I'm not offering terms, Mr. Franco. I'm making demands.
And what if we choose not to comply?
Steps are now being taken to ensure that you will. You Americans have a great capacity for violence. But it is wild, unfocused. You will learn. Good day, gentlemen.
We are Yakuza, is what she says. This is pretty cool, actually. I like this. She starts abducting the bad guy's kids, and the Punisher is listening in on their conversation. Where does he get these wonderful toys?
Toys, yes.
This town needs an enema.
So Gossett Jr. and his partner, who I will call Sparky, are looking for Frank Castle, a.k.a. the Punisher. To me, the Punisher makes more sense than Batman because he has a serious reason to get out there and kick ass rather than Batman for me anyway.
And his whole reason for living is you know, as a family man who lived for his family, is moved to revenge, and he's a really dark character.
Like, yes,
you know, I would say my two favorite comic book characters are Wolverine and the Punisher. I find them the most interesting. Their origin stories to be the most interesting. And
would you say that's because their motivation is their anger?
Yes, and although I find Wolverine is probably the most interesting to me because here's a guy who's been abused, taken, like made into a monster. He doesn't know how, who did it, why. But he wakes up with no memory of stuff, just living his life, and everything's been stolen from him, and he's fucking pissed off, and he should be, but he doesn't know where to focus it, you know, and that makes for a really interesting character getting into a lot of interesting situations right there,
right.
You know, and that I really like, and when you look at the Punisher, like I said, his whole reason for living has been taken away, and his new focus is to become this dark underground living in the sewer guy that does nothing but kill and get revenge. That's right. All he does. It's all he lives for. And that's an interesting character to comprehend as well, at least to me anyway. I don't know.
Yeah,
but I'm a fucking weirdo, so what do I know? I like dead heat.
Man's got to know his limitations.
You're not that weird.
I've come here to say one magic word to you. Cheeseburger.
You're not that weird. Okay, so we get to some clever stuff here. Next up, we're in a Frankie Goes to Hollywood video for relax for some reason. It's a weird stripper casino with muscular women. The Punisher drops in to kick some ass. Sweet Marshall.
Every day the children of God is going to cost you money. Take that message to your people.
He destroys all the booze and the gambling machines. He's like Jesus with a machine gun. I swear I saw a bottle of Fanta too. There was a bottle of Fanta in there mixed in with the booze.
Don't you wanna Fanta?
I don't understand how this drunk dude has all this information, but he winds up getting busted in the Coney Island amusement park, which actually isn't Coney Island.
Some Australian shit, because everything in this movie is not American.
America.
Yeah.
So he gets captured. They take his shirt, of course, those bastards. And Tanaka puts him on a rack and starts torturing him, and he has tiny nipples, and ow, that tickles, is what I was thinking, because she was running her little claw over his chest and tickling his nipples.
That was a very expensive question you asked at our place the other night. Cost us nearly $2 million in the cash. How much pain do you think that buys?
Is the question true, false, or multiple choice?
Neither.
Do you think I give a shit?
She leaves, but right before she leaves, he says, "Hey, have a nice day." I just thought that was a little bizarre. And of course,
and then
there
they
are
get him to talk by torturing the drunk guy instead.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I can't have my drunk guy tortured. I'll talk now.
And of course, there are wing nut screws on his shackles so they can get out of them easily.
Of course. Well, yes. That's how shackles work. I mean,
where you can get to them very easily. Lady Tanaka, don't you think it's a bad idea that we put wing nuts on here? Because those are perfect for to get off yourself.
I am the Yakuza. I like my wing nuts.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that? What did you say? I am Yakuza. I like my wing nuts.
Yakuza. We invented wing nuts.
Sounds like something you'd order in a restaurant. I'll have the wing nut chicken.
Wing nuts, yes.
Lightly braised.
I have the Kung Pao wing nuts.
So he, of course, escapes. He rescues the kids in a very thrilling bus chase scene, which I thought was cool.
Hey, this is fun, isn't it? We're going to die, aren't we?
But he is arrested, of course, and Gossett Jr., his old partner, tells him he's going to get the death penalty, which is kind of fucked up.
It is kind of fucked up. Gossett Jr. is a douchebag. Fuck him. Back to Iron Eagle.
I just figure, you know, when it comes to good and bad in the world, he's a force for good. I mean, he doesn't go around.
Fucking officer and gentleman.
But then there's the one last kid who is Yeroen's kid, and I guess he breaks him out of jail and makes a deal with him. You help me with my son or something like that. Help me rescue my son, even though you should fucking kill me right now, which is exactly what I would have done. I would have said, fuck your son.
Or save the son and kill him. What do you need him for? Like,
well, there is an interesting bit. There's a great interesting bit where we're at the end. And the kid has a gun. He kills Yeroen, like he should. And then the kid has the gun. He's like, you're going to shoot me. He gets down on his knees.
I'm going to kill you.
Good. Maybe if you get it over with now, you won't grow up to be like him. Come on. Do it. Do it. Do it.
Very dark. The whole thing is very dark.
Definitely not as enjoyable an experience as watching Dead Heat.
I did a little research. I was trying to figure out how the hell this movie didn't get released in the United States, other than some little bits of violence that you would think would be blocked, at least in the UK, because they used to block violent movies like this. And this is pretty violent, actually. All I saw here is that there were discrepancies with different versions of the scripts, and there were various edits of the movie floating around. Which version did you see?
I don't know. I saw an early version, and then I got the screener before it was released on video.
Now that's interesting. That could have been a different earlier cut, because apparently
it could have been. Maybe that's why I liked it better.
There were 20 different versions of this movie floating around.
Yeah, and I think that the one that we've got now is not that great. I mean, the Blu-ray one, I don't know, man.
Well, I saw a version that had an interesting title on it, because it said New World Pictures, not
It said all nude.
Nude World Pictures. Nude that World. Is a company in and of itself. Nude World Pictures. Think about that for a second. Okay.
You know you want me, baby.
It said New World Pictures, but it said a credit was added that was obviously just added because it didn't match. It said Australia in parentheses. So I'm guessing that what I saw was some kind of Australian version of the movie. This I found out was interesting. New World Pictures owned Marvel at the time. They owned Marvel Comics. Wow. And I don't know how long they held on to that, because they did make the Fantastic Four in 1994, the movie that was never released.
Weren't there legal issues with the Punisher too? Like maybe there was a fight. It could have been a fight with Cannon. Both of them dying over Marvel, fighting over Marvel.
Well, at
shit.
That time, the comic Marvel was not. Marvel did not have the kind of stature that it has now. It was not like DC Comics. DC had a lot of stature as a result of Superman and Batman movies, and Stan Lee really didn't put much faith in the idea of any of these movies being made based on his comics. So and you'll notice he didn't even have a cameo. Now he has a cameo in everything he does,
right?
Every movie they make now. But here, this is an adult movie. This is not for kids. So it's an R-rated movie. It's a hard R again for violence. And there were much more violent movies released before this movie, but there is a bit where, like, he snaps a woman's neck. You know, this is usually, and this is a problem when you have females that are bad guys.
Yeah.
So they're all going to die, and a lot of terrible things happen to women in this movie. And I remember famously that you mentioned how much violence toward women was in the Deadly Prey and Deadliest Prey movies. This is pretty damn violent, too.
Yeah.
This is not politically correct, because you notice, I mean, most of the time, women don't get killed in movies. It's usually men who get killed, unless it's Death Wish 2 or something.
Right.
So, but I found it to be, you know, The Punisher I found to be fun. I thought it was a fun movie. It definitely puts you into it. And again, it's Goldblatt really does have this ability to kind of put you into it. I mean, at least for me, but
I was kind of, it was more work to watch this one than I had anticipated. And that was disappointing to me. It bothered me. Well, it lost me at the very beginning. It was Lou Gossett that really, really just didn't ring true to me, and that I don't know why that didn't bother me before. And Nancy Everhard didn't work, you know, like something, you know, I think something changes when you watch these movies in like remastered and HD, and like things become more clear than watching them on a CRT TV on, you know, pan and scan VHS. You know, it's just a different deal. And you see more, and it starts to like, and when things don't ring true, they're kind of more jarring. You know what?
He's
I never
an actor.
Noticed how bad Nancy Everhart's hair was until I saw it in HD.
Or maybe because it's 2016 and her hair looks silly now.
Well, yeah,
it's
that's
short.
True.
Why? Why did women do that to themselves? This is what my mother had hair like that too. I was just like, what?
Yeah,
I'm about my wife got a haircut today, right, and you know, I feel like she cut it a little too short, even though it's still long.
Well, my wife has short hair, but she
my wife has an enormous head, though, Andrew. You don't understand. She has an enormous head, and she needs to create the illusion that she has a smaller head by having longer hair. And I've told her this.
I haven't noticed her gigantic head.
Take a look at some pictures. I swear to God, she's got like two
I've
brains
met her
in there.
In person, and I didn't see a giant head, so
you
I don't
didn't
know.
See the second brain? It pulsates. She's going to kill me, because I'm keeping this in. I'm keeping this. I'm totally keeping this in.
I must have missed that.
No, anyway, no. Yeah, I guess I understand your flaws, but I think you're looking at it because you're seeing those flaws are kind of dated. They date the material a little bit. Yeah,
I think maybe that just brings out some of the like I'm saying, rather, I mean, because that could just be forgiven. But if there's any other problem with Nancy Everhard or what's his name, Lou Gossett. It just accentuates it and brings it out a little
he
bit.
He had a short hairstyle too.
Well, yeah, no hairstyle, yeah. But he always had that, so that's all
you
good.
Know what? He created that whole bald, black is
yeah,
beautiful
that's,
look.
That's just part of Lou Gossett, you know, that's who
I
he
like,
is.
Okay, can, you know, the thing is, I like Lou Gossett Jr. I do, I really...
I oh, I do too, wonderful. I love Lou Gossett Jr. I'm not trying to...
Remember Firewalker with Chuck Norris and Melody
yes,
Anderson?
Terrible movie.
I
yes.
loved it, I love that movie, really? Because I like the rapport between the two.
Ah, well, that was good. I always, you know, that's one of those movies I always wanted to like, but could never really sit through.
And I also love him in Jaws 3, and I'm not ashamed to admit, I love Jaws 3.
Really?
Absolutely. I love it. Because I love Louis Gossett Jr. He's like, he's like this, he's got this attitude, he's got this black attitude about him that's very similar yeah. to Garrett Morris in a way, and here he is running an amusement park in Florida or something, you know, SeaWorld. He's like, he's like, I'm not going to close down this park for some damn fish! He's like, give me some lights down there! Give me some shit down there!
Give me something down there!
I mean, that's great. I mean, I love, he's interesting. That's what's so wonderful about a lot of these actors from back then is that they're just interesting because they chew the scenery and it's fun. I mean, yeah.
Gossett is terrific.
But my problem with Louis Gossett Jr. in this movie is he is too good of an actor to be wasted in this part. They don't give him anything interesting to do. That's
no,
it.
And he doesn't fit it either. It just, it's not right. He just doesn't belong. Like it's not... You know, as much as I love Lou Gossett, he doesn't have a great range as an actor. There's only so far you can stretch him.
Yeah, yeah.
Like he plays Lou Gossett in every movie that he's in. And
well,
that's
yeah.
great.
But that's, you know, great. That Al Pacino does that too. Jack Nicholson yeah. does that too. Christopher Walken yeah. does that.
Oh,
know.
Yeah. I'm not saying that it doesn't
method.
Have a place.
It's
I'm just saying in this particular role, it required, really should have had, I don't know, required, but it really should have had somebody yeah. a little bit darker, more serious, like because this, you know, that character, I can't remember his name, but like that character is kind of like almost as fucked up as Castle is.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, and you don't get that from him. You don't get the sense of
but I don't
or anything from.
I don't know. I have a feeling with a better script and more of a reason for his existence and his dialogue, he could have been much yeah, better maybe. Than he was. All right, let's wrap this up. What do you say?
Let's do it.
All right. So we were agreed on Dead Heat. We both love the movie. You know, Goldblatt takes kind of a step backward to tell a very, very simple, kind of rudimentary action movie story with the Punisher. It's lacking the soul, strangely enough. Becky, the soul. What about
the soul?
Soul. It's...
I guess they found a way around that too, Doug.
But the Punisher, oddly, lacks soul. And I feel like it's a by-the-numbers kind of a thing that
it is.
Really,
yeah,
it doesn't go anywhere. And even though Andrew hasn't seen it yet, I do recommend that you see the 2004 version with Thomas Jane. Much, much better.
Yeah, I gotta get that.
Really, really quite good. Very good movie. We were, both me and Bronwyn actually liked it quite a bit. That's all she wrote.
Hallelujah! Holy shit! Where's the Tylenol?
And
alrighty.
This has been Extreme Cinema, Action and Exploitation Movies, How Do You Like My Porn Voice, with Andrew Ganke and David Lawler.
You have been listening to Extreme Cinema with Andrew LeGank and David Lawler.